Well, it's closer to the end of the year, and I've always struggled with making a top 10 films list for each year ever since I started making videos for this channel, and I really want to get better at this sort of thing in many ways. Usually, if I haven't done anything, I'll at least have a decent explanation for it. But then my wife will counter with, basically, if you want to do this kind of thing regularly, you should actually be doing this sort of thing. So now I'm getting out to doing this right now. It's kind of a morale boost for me. Plus, I should really start doing more stuff like this. So anyway, I'm getting into this now. As a disclaimer, keep in mind, I have not seen every film of this year, as is the issue with every film critic, film pundit, pretty much anybody who makes these kind of videos. Nobody can see every single movie. And as a separate disclaimer, because I have so many movies that I have seen this year that I haven't actually been able to get around to doing reviews for, because this was a very stressful and busy year for me outside of all of this. There will be a few films mentioned that I haven't even reviewed yet, but we'll get to in the near future. This video is also being made before I get the chance to see like the last three films that I'll see in this year that's coming to the nearby theater, which are Spies in Disguise, Queen and Slim, and Little Women. The first one being one that I'd be very surprised if it came close to actually breaking anywhere on this list. And also, I still haven't seen The Irishman yet. I keep trying not to put it off, but I will admit that runtime is a little bit intimidating, and also I'd be worried that I wouldn't have enough time to finish it in one day in case something pressing comes up. But and of course, this list does not necessarily tell you what the best films of quality are for this year, in my opinion. These are primarily the ones that I've enjoyed the most and would definitely watch many times in the future. All right. Now, with that being said, let's start off my favorite films of 2019 by starting off with a couple of honorable mentions, the ones that came really close to the top 10 but were beaten out by the films that ended up actually making this list. And I have two honorable mentions that missed by a margin, though I can't really exactly describe what a margin is in this context, but anyway, here they are.
But what can I say?
Well, this seems excessive. Shotgun. Just kidding. I don't have one.
How long have we been on this rock? 5 weeks? 2 days? Help me to recollect.
To start off this top 10 list is a film that I wasn't even sure that I was going to be able to watch until maybe sometime next year, but lo and behold, I was fortunate enough to actually have it come to my theater before I came here to South Korea. And the funny part is that this is actually a South Korean film. This is a film that I obviously haven't gotten around to reviewing, or scratch that, a film that I obviously haven't gotten around to filming, which I'm probably gonna allude to that or outright say it with quite a couple of films on this list. This was a film that crept onto my radar after I heard so many glowing reviews coming out of the festival circuits, and I wasn't very familiar with the work of the director, Bong Joon-ho. Except I was fairly aware of his name. But this film has made me very interested in his filmography. Now, granted, I don't personally think that it's a masterwork that many people have claimed it to be, and I do feel like its pacing drops significantly in some of the parts of the film, namely in the end after the big climax moment. And it just feels like the movie should have ended at the climax, but it keeps going for like maybe five plus minutes or so. But I love this depiction of this poor household finding a way to scheme this much wealthier family by posing as these employees of theirs that are not related to each other. And I loved how, because the rich family was really smart, the poorer family had to be even smarter. And it was riveting to experience. I also think it's strange that this movie is being is praised when a scene near the end hits the same kind of thematic tone as another film from this year that was heavily criticized for it. And I will actually bring up that film later in the list. And now for my number 9 pick.
Remain fully committed to the lawful completion of the mission. If necessary, I will destroy the project in its entirety. The Earth put its hopes in him. And now, its fate is on me.
We have a job to do. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Just when I thought that Brad Pitt was going to be nominated just for Cliff Booth in Tarantino's Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, here came a movie that both made me second-guess myself on my decision and also made me think, could Brad Pitt be nominated for both Best Supporting Actor and Best Actor in the same year? Because Ad Astra, for me, was a film that I wasn't exactly sure what it was going in, other than it's the newest sci-fi movie in the vein of Interstellar. But I came out in awe. Not only did we get what I believe is Brad Pitt's best performance of his career, he gives it with a character who barely speaks. It's a character journey that, sure, has an end message about Earth and our relationship to it that has been showcased multiple times in many, many different films. But really, at its core, it's, like I said, it's a character journey surrounding a person who barely even speaks. But it's about a son's relationship with his father. And that a lot of that really, really, really moved me. And now for the number 8 spot.
I was made to help a child. I don't remember it being this hard.
Woody, somebody's whispering in your ear. Everything's gonna be okay.
At first, I wasn't even sure how to feel about Toy Story 4. Hell, I even went into the movie, like, I was sitting there before the Disney logo came up, just sitting there like, I don't know how I feel about this, but I mean, like most people, I thought the third one was such a perfect way to end the story with the iconic So Long Partner shot as Andy drives away for the last time. But this film really changed my mind on the idea as soon as the first scene happened. It showed that the Toy Story franchise could still tug at our heartstrings, you know, after so long, but it didn't need to stoop down to unneeded fan service to actually do it. It accomplished all of this with making a cohesive, connected story that really changed how Woody looked at a toy's role compared to how he felt about the toy's role in the last three movies. Forky was actually a funny and adorable character, and Gabby Gabby was a surprisingly great villain. I even said in my review of this movie, and I still think this, she's the best Toy Story villain. She's the most fleshed out, and she's just the best. And I have to say it again, the animation from Pixar keeps on getting better, especially when it comes to environments and weather. I mean, just in that first scene where it's raining, I wanted to cry because it looked so real. And now for number 7.
Hey, I'm looking for Fred Rogers.
In here.
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? Please, won't you be my neighbor? Hello, neighbor.
Another film I haven't gotten around to reviewing specifically is this film. A film I was really looking forward to because I grew up with Mr. Rogers reruns, and I was especially a huge fan of the documentary Won't You Be My Neighbor, which God damn it, that movie... Not movie. That documentary should have been nominated for an Oscar, and it honestly should have won. And luckily, it seems like the majority of people in the movie news and movie entertainment space actually does agree with me, so that's actually really nice. But anyway, back to the film. Tom Hanks, of course, is as amazing as we thought he'd be. He's basically America's sweetheart playing America's sweetheart. I actually really like that saying. But what surprised me was the film surrounding Fred Rogers. This story of a man whose past has shut him out from getting proper closure with his father, and how Fred Rogers helped his new friend remember what's important in life. And not only that, the direction had a charm that I wasn't expecting. I personally expected a normal Oscar-baity movie that was still pretty good, but they went far out with this film, making this many scene transitions call back to the scene transitions on Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, even staging the film as though it's a story being told inside the show itself, only with less puppets and singing. And for number 6... And I think it's gonna be a long, long time till touchdown brings me round again to find I'm not the male they think I am at home. Oh, no, 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 I'm a rocket man. Rocket man, I'm running out of fuel, I'm half alone. Another movie that I wanted to show up for a long time, which I especially love biopics, especially if I really love the person, and I love Elton John. Rocket Man came at a time when I needed it for its message, especially of just remembering to love yourself, something that I've struggled to do, I've struggled with for many years, and I still struggle with it to this day. And whenever I start to feel that way, I could just go onto my Amazon Prime account and I can turn on Rocket Man. Now, a great message that resonates with me is all well and good, but we also get a very strong performance from Taron Egerton as Elton John, and just the structure of the film as a musical in the vein of Moulin Rouge, where it's this kind of fantastical story, helps keep this film from becoming just another biopic, you know, in a row that's basically the same, and it really does play up this based or inspired by a true story aspect. And for number 5...
Hey, Jojo, my old friend.
Hi, Adolf.
What's wrong, little man?
They call me a scared rabbit. Jojo
Rabbit! Let them say whatever they want. People used to say a lot of nasty things about me. Oh, this guy's a lunatic. Oh, look at that psycho. He's gonna get us all killed.
A very strange-sounding film when it was announced by Taika Waititi, who was off the heels of the acclaim that he garnered from the masses for Thor Ragnarok, and he was getting back to his more indie roots with films like Hunt for the Wilder People or What We Do in the Shadows. Jojo Rabbit was a film that I waited way too long to see, because every time that I'd look at the inside trades and they'd have a release date, I'd be sitting there waiting like a couple of days before, waiting to just snipe for my ticket, and it just never came, and I always thought it was weird because it would say something like, I don't remember the specifics, but it would say like, you know, the release date is on October 1st or something like that, and then it'd get there and I'd be like, what the fuck? And then I'd look elsewhere and they'd be like, oh, no, that's the limited run. No, you have to wait for the wide release, which is on the 14th, and then I'd be like, okay, I'm just waiting for the 15th. Get it? It's still not there. And then I look again, and apparently it was a wide release, but it's supposed to go wider later. So I'm sitting there like, what the hell? Because there was a point where the only theater that I could find in the state that was playing it was 5 hours away. And I was like, as excited as I am for this movie, no. But then in actual mid-October... we were finally able to see it, and I'm happy that I did before and after the viewing. This film knew when to be funny, which, by the way, this is a great comedy. It knew when to be funny and when to pull back and tackle the more heart-wrenching dramatic moments, showing that Taika Waititi has grown as a director and can tackle basically any kind of genre if he sets his mind to it. And plus, I think we'll be able to see that soon with the very last episode of Mandalorian, which he'll be directing. Plus, his imaginative version of Adolf Hitler, I never thought I'd say those words ever, or anything close to those words. But anyway, his version of Adolf Hitler is spellbinding, and the film led to a breakout performance from Roman Griffin Davis as Jojo. And honestly, any reason to see Thomasin McKenzie after her breakout performance in 2018's Leave No Trace is always a good time for me. And for my number four pick, the film that shared a few thematic connections, let's say, with Parasite. A film that riveted me when I saw it. The Joker is a film that has taken the world by storm and could maybe go down as a film that's as divisive as The Last Jedi, only somehow, from where I'm sitting, it doesn't look like the DC fandom at this point is as toxic as the Star Wars fandom. It's mostly normal, everyday people who are complaining about the movie and what the supposed messages are and the themes, which I'm not going to argue with anybody. I'm just saying, in my opinion, the majority of the complaints are wrong. Again, that's just me. So this film is another one that showcased what comic book movies could be, you know, and that they could be more than just comic book movies, you know, after films like Logan or Dark Knight or even Unbreakable many years before the other two that I mentioned prior. This was a masterwork that I did not truly expect to be as good as it was. I knew it was going to be something interesting, but I don't know if I could actually have expected that I was going to react the way that I did. And, you know, I even said in my review when I made it that I had no doubt that this was going to be Joaquin Phoenix's year to get an Oscar. But I'll be honest, there's another film on this list that actually made me question that, potentially, and I'll talk about it when I actually get there. On a side note, I do actually, this film is going down a little bit for me in, it was a little bit higher on the list, like, a couple of days ago, but I don't know, the fact that the director and other crew members keep explaining away the more ambiguity, but it wouldn't even have sounded right, but the way that they keep explaining away the ambiguous scenes of Joker, it kind of ruins the quality of the movie. It's actually one of those movies where if you leave the ambiguity, it's better, but then when you just go explaining everything, it kind of loses its shine in a way. And here we are, starting off the top three with number three.
I've eliminated no suspects.
I'm gonna live until I...
It's a twisted web. We are not finished untangling it, not yet.
What is this? CSI KFC?
As a well-documented fan of Rian Johnson, who discovered him with the movie Looper and thinks that his directorial debut, Brick, is a singular masterpiece, and also as somebody who did actually enjoy The Last Jedi, Knives Out had a lot to live up to for me, and it didn't disappoint. Granted, I'll need to watch it a couple more times to at least see where it lands in his filmography for me, but this was the kind of mystery film that I needed, that played with the expectations of the genre, something that Johnson's really well known for doing, and just basically taking my expectations of the normal structure of the film and just throwing everything out the window. And it was also a wholly original mystery film, which I don't think we've had a high-profile original mystery film in a long time. This was a true ensemble film with some big, high-profile cast members. that just everybody was giving their all, and you could tell everybody was having a great time while filming this movie. And though it's a mystery film, it plays like a tension-filled comedy, and this is my favorite comedy of the year. And on to number two. That this film exists still fucks with my mind. I mean, growing up, I could barely even contemplate the existence of the first Avengers film, and that movie only had like 6 heroes in it. Avengers Endgame has all the fucking heroes, all of them, and this level of fan service should not have worked. Hell, I've already touched on in another video of mine a film from this year that took the exact same approach, and it fell flat and felt disingenuous all throughout whenever they stooped to fan service. Endgame works out because of 2 core aspects for me. I believe this is why these are the 2 main reasons why Endgame works after, you know, it having been out for over half a year. It's in the compelling narrative, and also just the fact that this movie is a love letter to fans. It's their way of saying thank you, and nothing ever feels like they're trying to pander. I still watch this movie and I cry tears of joy in the credits, and especially in the portal scene, which is my favorite pure feel-good and entertaining scene of 2019, and I mean, who can argue with the epicness of this?
Avengers!
I'm trying not to tear up right now, but just this movie and just the MCU in general, this 10 plus year saga that's still going on, just makes me feel like a kid again when I could experience Star Wars and just love it unabashedly and purely, even though I didn't care for the prequels. I still loved the idea of Star Wars, and I can't even do that anymore, even though I've enjoyed the majority of the new Disney Star Wars movies. And now, moving on to my number one pick, and I wasn't expecting this a week ago, but here it is. The film that I loved the most in 2019 is No, not that movie. Jesus, no. No, that would be for a different list. Okay. All joking aside, here's my real favorite.
What I love about Nicole, she is a mother who plays, really plays.
What I love about Charlie, he loves being a dad. He loves all the things you're supposed to hate, like waking up at night.
She knows when to push me and when to leave me alone.
He never lets other people keep him from what he wants to do.
Dad, you're too far.
I know. It's not easy for her to close a cabinet.
He's incredibly neat.
She's brave.
He's brilliant.
He's
very competitive.
So I'll tell Charlie what's happening, and Cassie, you then hand him the envelope.
I just get nervous.
Well, can you unserve?
What do you mean, like take it back? Charlie and I are getting a divorce, Mom.
You can't be friends with him anymore.
Gee, Ma!
Charlie Bird!
Mom?
What?
You know, most people in my business, you're just transactions to them. I like to think of you as people.
Oh, okay, good.
You remind me of myself on my second marriage.
Baby, I'm amazed the way you love me all the time.
Part of what we're gonna do together is tell your story.
Did you dye your hair again?
No, this is me. You don't like it?
Is it shorter? I prefer it longer, but...
How are you doing?
I realized I didn't ever really come alive for myself. I was just feeding his aliveness.
I'll never get to really be his parent again. He needs to know that I fought for him.
It's not as simple as not being in love anymore.
Eventually, it'll be the two of you having to figure this out. Together.
If we start from a place of reasonable and they start from a place of crazy, when we settle, we'll be somewhere between reasonable and crazy.
As you no doubt saw from the trailer, this is a Netflix film, so you can easily watch this movie after. I didn't see this movie until just last week, and I can't wait to do a review on this. So just plain and simple, I watched it once, and at that point, you know, I haven't watched it once. I'll tell you how many times I've already watched it in the past week or so. But first time I watched it, I was floored with how great a film this was. And there's nothing that really stands out visually or technically, aside from some very long takes, which I love. I love when a film's not just quick edited and it'll just stay in one place, or it'll just be a continuous camera movement. Anyway, I'm rambling. Just aside from all that stuff, what really sells the film is the story and the performances from Adam Driver and Scarlett Johansson. This is a modern answer to Kramer versus Kramer, and we get this film about divorce that is tackled from both sides, unlike Kramer versus Kramer. And there's no outright villain in this movie. Both characters are brilliant and nice, and they're both douchebags at the same time. They're just, it's showing two people who are just not good for each other in a relationship. And it's just, it's a more grounded and realistic depiction of a divorce that isn't just arguments all the way throughout the film, which makes the single argument scene that much more potent when all the emotions are thrown about. And it's the best acted scene of 2019. It may even be one of my favorite acted scenes of all time. And this is just me saying it after I've seen it. I know I probably need a lot longer to actually decide that, but it's a feeling that I have. And this film also has my favorite character moment of 2019, and it's a scene where someone is singing. It's one of those kinds of scenes that I wouldn't expect to see in films these days. And it's not just the fact that it's singing, it's the singing is being used as like a cathartic sort of therapy for the character. And I don't know, the funny thing is that despite this movie having a slightly dark concept of divorce surrounding the film, I just keep on watching. I watched it 8 days ago, I've watched it 5 times, and I've just, I don't know why, I usually can't just keep watching this kind of movie that, you know, has this depressing aura around it, but it's just because of how powerful and how great this movie is. And really, I've been a champion for this film with my friends, with my friend groups, and at my workplace. Please, guys, if you have not seen this movie, jump on Netflix the next chance you get, and just sit down and experience this film. Now, as I mentioned earlier, my throat is starting to hurt, so I'm gonna try to speed this up. As I mentioned earlier, I am doubting that this is Joaquin's year to get an Oscar. That's because of Adam Driver in this film. I don't know who to champion into Oscar season because I'm stuck between two chameleonic performances on two different sides of the spectrum called life. And just, I don't know. From what I've seen, despite a shit ton of bad movies that I've seen this year, this ended up being a very great year for film, and I'm really happy. So, there you go. There's my top 10 list of 2019. Thank you guys so much for watching it. I hope you enjoyed it. I definitely enjoyed watching this. It was, actually, most of my videos I see as a sort of therapy for me. But also, it gives me a chance to talk about the things that I love. Anyway, Please don't forget to hit that like button, and as always, farewell until the next video, all of you casual moviegoers and movie fans alike, and keep on being awesome.